record this. I want to share my screen with you. So I needed to be able to walk you through so that everyone can see what Tammy Clark and I, including my husband, have been talking about. So as of now, you know that we have been calling out OSHA, and OSHA has been sitting with their thumb up their butt. They have not been following the laws that have been on the books for decades upon decades regarding the respiratory protection program. I've said this before. I've managed the respiratory protection for well over 75,000 people. It was my primary specialty during my 9 years on active duty, and also through 3 years when I had worked at the VA. I know the standard of 29 CFR 1910.134 up and down. So when I saw that employers were mandating masks, my first thought was, this absolutely violates this very standard I'm just citing. You can see on my screen here, I'm going to go to the top. I wanted to show you something. We have been talking about how OSHA has been citing people for things that they would have been praised for months ago before COVID. So here in Ohio, OSHA actually did their job. And this right here is setting case precedents. This occurred back in July, but I just want to point out to you how things have changed and continue to flip-flop. All right, so take a look here over at the screen. You'll see that this is a company right here, this OHNHEMP LLC, and it is a nursing home, I believe, in Ohio. Now, the first few pages we're not going to go through. This just talks about that you've been cited, and this is standard write-up from OSHA that just talks about your rights, of how you need to post this citation, how you can fight the citation, how you pay the citation, and you always have to give notice of corrective action, all that. So that's all this is. Let's take a look about what OSHA cited this company for. Because this, my friend, is how OSHA should be working. This is noted as a serious violation. There are numerous types of violations. The most common is willful and serious when we're dealing about healthcare facilities. And it talks about on or around March 17th, there was use of respirators. And it goes in to talk about how they implemented the use of N95s for these employees, but they did not implement, right here in Section A, the policy does not include provisions for medical evaluations. What have Tammy and I have been saying? When you're utilizing PPE, even if it's an N95, yes, you need medical clearance and a fit test and training. But even when you're using elective use, face masks like a nuisance mask, a dust mask, or a facial covering, anything that is designed to control a hazard is called PPE. And at a minimum, you still need a written respiratory protection program that is at a minimum documenting that you've informed the employees that this mask is not going to protect them against the virus, because they're not. The dust masks, the ear loop masks, the surgical masks, the homemade masks, none of them are rated nor proven to protect against a virus, not of the size. We've covered this up and down. That is fact. So if people are going to wear masks in the workplace, they have to, again, at a minimum, have this written program that says they inform them of the limitations of the masks and the training, how to properly don it, doff it, when you change it out, and things like that. So here, again, cited, it did not provide medical evaluations for the employees. It did not include provisions for the fit testing, which I've, again, conducted well over 10,000 of those. And the policy did not include procedures for cleaning, disinfecting, storing, inspecting, repairing, discarding, and otherwise maintaining respirators. Some of these provisions that you're seeing right here in Part C1B is it is saying that you need to store respirators and masks in a clean, dry area. This is why when we talk about wearing masks during exercising or not properly using them in the workplace, it's because the second they become soiled, they fail. And that's why under D here, Part C is talking about how they were not trained on how to properly store them and inspect them. Because you don't just throw on a mask, you need to check for its integrity, especially if you're wearing it more than once, which there were only special exemptions because of the shortages. And Part D is saying the policy did not outline procedures for training employees and in the proper use of respirators include putting on and removing them, also known as donning, and doffing them, and again, the limitations of their use and their maintenance. So here we are, corrected during inspection. There are proposed penalties here. I believe that the full amount of this is close to $14,000. It talks here about how the exact areas that they're citing, how they need to have medical evaluations. Why do we need medical evaluations for an N95? Well, because it's shown that N95 respirators can impede proper gaseous exchanges. It can lower carbon dioxide, and that's why N95s are generally used in control environments governed by ASHRAE standards that are put together by architects and engineers in certain settings. And in healthcare settings, again, they're set with certain humidity, oxygen content, air exchanges per hour, positive pressure, negative pressure. There's so many different issues depending on if it's a surgical suite, infectious disease ward, administrative setting, radiology, labs, sterilizing units. They all have their own parameters for those rooms. So again, just putting on a mask is not just saying like put your socks on. There are major health implications that can occur if you're just putting a mask on the average person without having them fill out the medical questionnaire and determine if they need a further physical to determine the usage and limitations and the time periods and temperature settings in which they'd be using these masks. So I just wanted to point this out because this, yes, I mean, you can have your view on government and all that, but this is how OSHA is supposed to operate. OSHA is supposed to hold employers to their own standards. And back in March, when we decided that there was a virus, there is a known workplace inhalation hazard for an infectious disease, PPE is a last resort. And in these settings, I get why PPE is utilized, because if this is a nursing home, or even if there's any sort of extension of home healthcare aid, you can't send a nurse with you into a home healthcare aid with engineering controls like a capture ventilation and dilution ventilation. Yes, there are some administrative controls you can put in place, and I'm sure that they were. So yes, sometimes PPE is a last resort, but it's the only resort based on the type of work that's completed. So this is an actual validated, this is correct and how they were cited. Again, I did not do the inspection. I've done multiple open OSHA inspections. I do ISO inspections, Joint Commission inspections. I'm credentialed to do all of those throughout my career. So I just wanted to go over this. This company is now facing this amount of money, just shy of $14,000, because they failed to follow OSHA. Now let's dial back into the future. Now we've got companies being cited for not putting their personnel in masks. And I don't care if you want to say that N95s are respirators and fall under different laws. Now that we've bumped up homemade facial coverings, surgical masks, and ear loop masks, which were not typical forms of PPE, they were considered elective use PPE, or had their own limitations. Again, surgical masks that were created so that spit from the surgeons and assistants and anesthetists and everyone in there not getting into the open wounds to maintain the sterile environment. But that had to do with large particles like spitting and coughing, not nanoparticulates, not small particulates, not little microns. That's not what it's for. When we needed to operate on a patient who had a heavy infectious disease, the personnel that were performing the surgery wore power air purifying respirators with a clear visible see-through all the way to here. You can see through it. There's no hindrance in the view. And a lot of times it was used in conjunction with like Da Vinci units anyway. But that's just a little background for my expertise. So again, now we're seeing people who say, and I can't remember what was it, the meatpacking plant in South Dakota, who I believe is fully being targeted because their governor, how dare she control her state in a constitutional manner. Now you've got the opposite things going on. So I need to go ahead and research the follow-up from these citations, because you have so many days to contest an OSHA violation and citation, because you have the right to a hearing. So I'm going to further look into this, but I just want to point out that once case precedent is set, boy, is this going to be fun. All of you companies who are being cited for not having a written respiratory protection program, take note of this, because now they're doing the complete opposite, and it's hilarious. It's harmful, but I'm to the point where it's hilarious, because Tammy and I have been calling this out. Other people from our career field have been calling this out, more on a silent point of view because of fear of losing their jobs. But I just can't help but wanting to share this with you guys, because OSHA did their job here, and now they're citing other people in other states. Like here, my OSHA is citing people, and in South Dakota, they're citing people for doing the complete opposite of what the OSHA laws say. So Stay tuned. Tammy and I have some good information coming up next week. We have a special surprise for you. It's going to be a real doozy. You're going to want to pay attention. There's a lot going on behind the scenes. I've lost my voice the past few days, so I really haven't been on here, but please share this. Let's go ahead and point out the hypocrisy with our government facilities and administrations that cannot seem to get their shit together in the name of, well, political games and being weaponized.